Welcome to
Take
Off
Your
Pants
and
Oh wait, no, Pod
and
Cast It.
Bingo.
How's everyone doing tonight?
Welcome back. I hope the world hasn't ended. We're recording these a couple weeks in advance.
Yeah, we're doing it. And I'm in the fucking mood.
I'm
to party.
How was your week?
It's been good, yeah. Went on a Target date last night with my boyfriend, and then we're going to start recording the new Lips album this week.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, we're going to do a 5-song EP with my new hardcore band Lips.
An EP.
Yeah. I can't get them to cover Blink-182.
Yeah, that doesn't line up.
No. Today we're talking about the Mark, Tom, and Travis show.
The Enema Strikes Back.
That's true.
It wasn't till years later when I got into Dude Ranch, or a year or two later, and heard A New Hope, that I realized, Enema Strikes Back is a Star Wars.
Yeah. Did you have this album?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I think this was the first thing I got, maybe? Like, the first physical album I got.
Okay.
I think I downloaded Take Off Your Pants and Jacket, but then, like, got this.
Yeah.
And it holds up.
It really does. It's a fantastic live album. We've got Jerry Finn behind the mixer once again. I had to buy an Australian import of this off the internet.
Whoa.
In the year 2001. Because there were only 500,000 copies released in America.
That seems crazy.
Yeah.
Given the fact that the album that most of these songs are from went so hardcore platinum.
It got re-released with Take Off Your Pants and Jacket. But yeah, there was a period where it was out of print, hard to find. But it was still in print in Australia. I think I spent like $35 on a CD.
That's a lot of weeks of allowance.
It's a lot of money back then. I was working at a pool snack bar, so that was 7 hours of work. I was making $5 an hour.
Wow.
Yeah.
Was that your first job?
It was.
Where at? Like just a pool?
Yeah, just like a neighborhood pool in Waldorf, Maryland. It was all paid under the table because I was well below the appropriate age to work.
I was gonna say.
Yeah. Microwaving hot dogs and giving out Fun Dip.
Uh-huh. That's fun.
Yeah. Great live album.
Oh, it's like my favorite live album.
Probably.
I mean, I don't know if that's true, but listening to it, revisiting all this stuff, I keep making the mistake of thinking this stuff I love isn't going to hold up years later because I haven't listened to it all the way through since then.
Well, because you watch some movies sometimes that you loved as a kid and they really don't hold up.
Yeah.
And I can't think of any music that I've listened to where I'm like, wow, no, this doesn't hold up.
I mean, there's like the less iconic pop punk bands to me. Like there was a long period, not a long period, there was a chunk of my life. That still sounds bigger than it is. When they were popular, Good Charlotte meant the fucking world to me.
Dude, all right, that's the next series. Because like, I felt the same way, and I recently listened to Self-Titled by Good Charlotte. Album fucking slaps.
Does it?
Undeniable bangers on the Self-Titled. Lifestyles and the Rich and the Famous still holds up a little bit, but they were a band that, like, those two, that's all you need. They got, like, weird later on.
They definitely got weird. It was the two albums for me, those first two.
The Madden Brothers became fantastic producers, though.
I did not know that.
Yeah, they've actually produced the last two Anti-Flag albums and co-wrote some of the songs, and it's their best stuff in years.
I saw Anti-Flag last night.
No shit, where?
At Black Cat.
Damn, how were they?
They were fucking fantastic.
Yeah, they're amazing live. They're one of the best live punk rock bands.
I hadn't seen them since the first time I ever heard them, which was Warped Tour, like 04 or whatever. And I was right up front. Doll Skin opened, and then Bad Cop, Bad Cop, who
they're
we've seen
great.
Together.
They're fucking awesome.
Yeah. And then Anti-Flag, and goddamn, like, I was right up front, maybe. There was, like, some kids right up front, like, people brought their kids, and then, like, a group of protective adults, like, sort of, like...
Were you one of those protective adults?
Yeah. But I was the second layer of them, so
nice.
I was...
Dude, that's great.
I was technically three people back, but, like, you've been to the Black Cat a ton, I'm sure. There's no barrier. I was right between Justin and Chris. Chris was his name? And
well, Justin is in between two Chris's. So.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's why I'm confused.
There's Chris number two and Chris Head.
Yes. Dude, I always said Matt Freeman and Mike Dirnt, greatest bassist in all of punk rock.
Dude, no. Chris number two and an amazing hype man.
Dude, seriously.
He is the hype man of all hype men.
Well, my memory of Warped Tour, and as I'm realizing as we talk about this stuff, like maybe my timeline and memories are all off.
Yeah.
But my memory of Warped Tour was that Justin was like the one that was like in your face and getting everyone crazy.
He's kind of calm and collected. Like he does go hard when he's playing, but it's Chris. A well-rounded set list?
Yeah. So we did the Anti-Flag tribute show for Punks for Presents,
yeah,
2 years ago, right?
Yep.
And that was me mostly learning a bunch of songs. I knew like three of them beforehand, and then you guys were like, these are all the other ones people will get hyped for. And so I expected them to play like all of those songs. They played 17 songs and I knew five of them.
Okay.
But it was still awesome.
I want to look up this set list real quick.
Bring Out Your Dead.
Oh, hell yeah. I haven't seen them play that ever.
That was the first song they played that I knew, but it was still like seven songs in.
That bass line is what, that bass line blows my mind.
Dude, just watching him play bass while he's singing is the craziest thing I've ever seen. I've never seen somebody so proficient at an instrument. He's Travis Barker levels of good at bass.
Yeah. No, and it seems so like easy to him. He seems like he's not trying at all.
My mind was blown. And Justin Sane is like the hottest man I've ever seen.
Yeah, he's very attractive.
I could not get over it.
Wow, the album they played most stuff from was American Fall, which is
the Madden Bros?
The first Madden Bros one. But this set list is just, it's all over the place. You have 11 albums represented in that set list.
Whoa.
You've got two songs from most of their albums. That's great. Yeah. I love when a band does that.
Me too.
And like People Are the Gun, which is my favorite one, which is like a weird one from 2009.
Mm-hmm.
They got some good songs off that.
Was the most recent one that we played at our set, was it This Is the End?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they got four songs off of that because that was their breakthrough album. That was their like American Idiot had just come out album.
The only album I ever had from them back in the day, like that I bought right after I saw them, was Terror State. But yeah, they did. I
fucking love that record.
Me too. They did Turncoat, Die for Your Government is what they closed with.
Sick.
It fucking rocked. And I'm so glad you guys made me get more into them.
That's great. That's awesome.
You know, when your mind is being open to a new genre of music when you're 14, you think it can never get that better than that. Last night was just as good.
Dude, awesome.
As when I saw them at Warped Tour.
Live performance, like, so when I get into a new band, if they have one, I seek out the live album. That's what represents a band the most to me.
Yeah.
And to get us back on topic, I really think Mark, Tom, and Travis Show is a great representation of a band at their prime.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you brought up Anti-Flag, though, so I didn't have to find a way to squeeze it in that I went last night.
Yeah.
This live album fucking rules. They open with Dumpweed. No, let's just talk for a second. Is this album, is there studio recordings on this?
At the end. However,
you know what I'm trying to ask.
Yeah, so I think there are overdubs. I really do. However, in my research today, it kind of seemed more like they were taking... So it was recorded over two nights in California in early 2000, like right after they broke.
Mm-hmm.
This is their first tour after Enema of the State went multi-platinum.
The like first arena tour thing.
Yeah, first arena tour. And it was recorded over two performances. And I think it's more that they doubled the guitars from both nights.
Mm-hmm.
Because it sounds really produced.
It does.
And so, like, a long time I thought it was overdubs. But I'm not really sure anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Listened to it a lot this week.
Mm-hmm.
Been listening to it a lot since we started this podcast. Because it's one of my favorite things, second favorite thing by this band.
Yeah. I like every track on this more than on Enema of the State.
Yeah.
Like, all the same songs.
Well, because they're sped up.
Yeah, I guess.
And
yeah.
That, I mean, no, they play these songs a lot faster on these albums. You can look at... If you were to take away the banter at the end of the tracks, they're much shorter than their other versions. Something cool to look at here, the plays on Spotify are all pretty much identical.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, they are.
people listen to this album all the way through. And then Man Overboard's at 40 million.
Whoa.
Yeah. It's the only place to find that song, you know?
Yeah.
But
like you said, you listen to a band's live album. I've always sort of maintained that, like, yeah, I get why bands do studio recordings. You want to get, like, the quote-unquote perfect take separate from everything else so nothing else is, like, bleeding into it. And then you line it all up, and then you got the perfect track or whatever. But there's a kismet. There's a working togetherness of a band that you get in live albums that just does not exist on the
Absolutely.
Album.
Absolutely. It's interesting because this is towards the end of the era in music where you toured to sell the album. Because nowadays you sell the album to tour.
Yeah, you make an album just for an excuse to tour, right?
Yeah. And that change has happened with Spotify and the death of buying music and the devaluation of art and music. I mean, I'm sure that they're not making any money off of Nine. Maybe a little bit. Maybe some Spotify royalties, but they're, you know.
Or just that the initial signing of it.
Yeah.
Of like, you record an album, you'll get this amount of money, and that's like what they're banking on.
I imagine the Dark Side music video, they got some money from Target.
Uh-huh.
I'm sure that it isn't explicit, but that video is sponsored by Target.
Yeah, when you pointed that out, I couldn't believe it.
Released on November 7th, 2000. Fun little facts. The album sleeve was designed by Glenn Hansen, who received a award for graphic design for this album. Kind of kickstarted his career because shortly after he made this album, he started working on Monster High.
I don't know Monster High.
It's apparently like a doll line that was really big in the mid-10s.
Okay.
And so he's like a big deal in like the toy community, I must have missed
that wall in Hot Topic.
Yeah, this was way before. After both of our times.
Oh, okay.
This is a Zoomer thing.
Isn't it weird when you walk by Hot Topic? It seems like a relic of a bygone era.
I've never seen anyone in Hot Topic since, like, 2012.
Yeah, but, like, the rare times you have a reason to go to a mall.
Yeah, you check it out. You see what's going on there.
I, like, peek in there, and I'm like, well, it still looks like 04 in there.
Yeah, it's still Nightmare Before Christmas merch, but it's a lot more Cartoon Network stuff.
Oh, yeah, Rick and Morty are right next, are wearing American Idiot shirts.
Yeah. marketed as a limited release, available for only 2 months in retail.
So nuts that they wouldn't just like bank on this selling a lot.
I think that it was an early example of like the Supreme logic of like exclusivity breeds publicity.
Oh, true.
Which wasn't as big of a thing in the 2000s, but Mark Hoppus recalled that we had gone from playing small clubs to sleeping on people's floor to headlining amphitheaters and staying in 5-star hotels. Tom DeLonge says it was amazing. It was the first time we'd ever done anything big. And Travis Barker... Reading up on this album, I feel like Travis Barker had like a little bit of disdain for this band in the early years.
Oh, yeah.
Just like the album took us all over the world for months at a time. We were playing award shows with Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera when we're used to hanging out with the Vandals and Unwritten Law. And he also talks a lot of shit about the dick jokes on this album in interviews and in his book.
I want to read his book.
Yeah.
I forgot. Can I say? Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah. Do you know Unwritten Law? Do you know that band?
I've seen them. They opened for Sum 41, and I got into them at that show. A classic Anti-Flag example of, like, I didn't know them until then. But I listened to Seeing Red again recently because I just remembered it. But that's the only song I really remember.
They're a band that they completely left my brain after, like, 2004. And until researching this podcast, I name was gone. Hadn't thought of them forever.
Elva.
Yeah, that was the album. But they seem to be real good buds with Blink-182.
My memory of the live show was, first it was Hawthorne Heights, and then Unwritten Law, and then Sum 41. Hawthorne Heights, worst band I've ever heard or seen.
Yeah, they're not great.
Not good. But
sorry if you like Hawthorne Heights.
Yeah, they're like a band I've seen like 4 times out of opening for various different people, and I could never get into them.
That's the Bouncing Souls for me.
Oh, yeah.
I see a lot of bands that like are opening for them, and then I happen to accidentally see the Bouncing Souls.
Uh-huh. I'm not into the Souls either.
They're fine.
Yeah, yeah.
But they do what they do well.
Unwritten Law had like a hardcore fan base at the Sum 41 show, like cool. Right up front.
That's great.
And like there, people were yelling. I remember a guy yelling in between songs of like, they should be opening for you. And then after Unwritten Law went off, all those people cleared and went to the back, so I was able to get right up front.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah.
I've seen moments like that. In high school, I saw the Gaslight Anthem open for Against Me, which felt appropriate. And then in 2014, I saw Against Me open for the Gaslight Anthem.
Whoa.
And a lot of people left after Against Me.
That makes sense. Those bands don't really go that together.
Eh, they kind of do. So, there was a time where Against Me and Gaslight both appeared to like the bearded 30-year-old Springsteen fan that claimed they were a punk. So, right here.
Sure, yeah. Yeah.
That's why I love both of those bands.
Songwriter-driven, fast rock music.
Yeah, that's like
pretty melodic.
Like, you know, coincidentally falls in the punk rock umbrella.
Uh-huh. I get that. There's a Venn diagram of those bands. So there's 30 seconds to a minute of jokes at the end of every single track.
It's true. I made my boyfriend listen to this morning when we were making pancakes. Who
what a cute little life you have.
His experience with Blink-182 is Skiba Blink-182.
That's nuts.
Yeah. Just a few years younger than me, and the difference is, which is crazy, but I was listening to this, and he was just like, are these guys in middle school?
Like, mentally, yes.
No, but I was when I heard it, and it blew my mind. Mm-hmm. This is why I do comedy.
Yeah.
This is why I'm a stand-up comedian. This album not only made me love punk rock and music, but it made me love comedy.
Yes.
And while yes, it is not genius Carlin level comedy, it appeals to, you know, your dumb little teenage brain. It's fart and dick jokes.
Yes.
And like oral sex jokes about getting laid, jokes about being gay. It's why I'm like hesitant to see Blink-182 now. And we covered it with Apple Shampoo last week.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want them to hold back. Mm-hmm. Like, be classic Blink. As a faggot, I give you my approval to make gay jokes on stage because they're funny.
Well, so that's what I wanted to ask you about. Like, with this, is like we've talked about with the other albums. Like, if some of those lyrics came out now, we'd be like, what the fuck, dude? With other bands or whatever. Like, if the stuff on this album was being said by new people today.
The innocence of it is what makes it funny and what makes it hold up for me, because it's almost cute, you know. Like, it's so harmless. Like, the gay jokes of the late 90s early 2000s in like American Pie and like The Hangover is one that you're like, wow, this is pretty homophobic. But like, especially this live album, I think, in a way, inspired this, like, thing amongst, like, cis boys and, like, cis teenagers of the early 2000s, like myself, to, like, make enough gay jokes that you all of a sudden became comfortable with homosexuality.
Right.
Like,
it normalized it.
It did. And you look at videos of this band hanging out, and, like, Tom and Mark are touching each other and being cute with each other. And it's, like, it's funny. We're joking about being gay, but they're also, honestly, being loving to each other.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, there's a moment in one of Bo Burnham's specials where he sort of, someone shouts out something from the crowd, like makes a gay joke, and the crowd laughs, and Bo like goes off on this kid. He's like, well, that's not God's way. How funny, or something like that. And it's like, dude, it would have been fine if everybody had just laughed at it. Now you're making that kid feel, who might be gay, feel like a fucking loser.
Well, Bo Burnham got, and we both have, I really like Bo Burnham. I know you do too.
Yeah.
But he has always had a lot of jokes like thrown at him about being an effeminate man. Mm-hmm. And, you know, had homophobic jokes thrown at him, even though he's, you know, on the record is straight. But he's always approached it in a really good way of just like, why is that a joke? If I was, why would that be funny?
Right.
And I think Blink-182's take of it is like, everything's funny. Like,
right.
And almost feels like an excuse for them to be like touchy-feely and close to each other sometimes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's what it was for me, because my friend group pretty sure that all of the dudes that were in my band in high school are queer now. And it was because, like, we were really into Blink-182 and make gay jokes with each other. And it just sort of, like, you get into, like, have you ever gotten into something ironically and it, like, became a part of your life?
Absolutely.
Yeah. That's how the homophobic jokes of the early 2000s felt to me.
Uh-huh.
Just one too many jokes about, like, oh, we're gay together, guys. And the next thing, you're sucking each other's dicks. It's just, like, it's the natural progression. I don't know. I think that if this came out now, I would still find it hilarious.
Yeah.
I think there would certainly be angry people. There always will be. Just like Fairy Tale in New York. Best Christmas song ever. We're coming up on Christmas time. It's the winter. And last year, the BBC radio station announced they wouldn't play the studio version of that song anymore because the line, you scumbag, you maggot, you cheap, lazy faggot. Shane McGowan was a drunk, like, 20-something-year-old loser when he wrote that song. He's not advocating violence against queer people.
Right.
At the point in that song, the two narrators are intentionally insulting each other, and that's the narrative of the song.
Interesting. Yeah, okay.
And I think that there is a lot of straight people that want to cancel things that they think are homophobic that queer people don't think are homophobic.
Oh, yeah. No, like, nobody wants to stop people from expressing ideas more than straight white liberals.
Yeah, and it's more of an issue of, like, hey, what about, like, proper healthcare for trans youth and the amount of queer people that are homeless? Mm-hmm. Can we talk about that instead of canceling a band for a funny song?
Dude, seriously. Yeah, if you're about the issues, get about the fucking issues.
Yeah, exactly. You know, don't change a pancake syrup bottle. Like, make some real changes. Defund the police.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I don't think that this album would be cancelable in 2021.
I always think about, I think it was some interview between Michelle Wolf and Chris Rock, and they were talking about,
I like both those people a lot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They were talking about use of the N-word on stage and the idea of white comics saying it. And this is like 10 or 12 years ago, so it's less of a hot topic. But I think the conclusion they came to, and they were like, we're not saying use it. I think it was Chris Rock who said, here's what I will say. The audience can tell if you mean it.
And it better be fucking hilarious.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, I think I saw that same interview, and Chris Rock is like, it better be funny.
Yeah. But he's like, if you say it and you and it is funny, that means that we can tell you didn't mean it. But if you say it and you mean it, and it's immediately the room can tell if it's something hateful.
Yeah.
That's what I apply to this.
Exactly. Yeah, so, yeah, definitely. The incest jokes bother me a little more, though.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and, like, the dog rape jokes and...
Interesting.
Hey, those are a little less comfortable, you know?
I didn't know you. That was a sore spot for you.
No, it's just those seem a little bit like, maybe you wouldn't do that in 2021, you know?
Somewhere else right now, there are two dogs barking on microphones going like, quit telling Drunk and Tom that they can't talk about fucking me.
Holy shit. Dog casts. I would listen to every one of those.
Take off your dog and jacket. All right.
There's a dog response podcast to our podcast.
We got to get these pups on the show.
It's like the Walking Dead show with Chris Hardwick.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
There's an after show, but it's hosted by two Pomeranians.
Both happen to be Pomeranians.
Yeah, those are the dogs I imagine having podcasts.
They're like, we like the dog incest jokes, but we don't like him saying, where's my Asian friend? All right, let's see how they close the opening song.
Wow! Hey, I'm fucking in the mood to party!
Hey, all right!
We're fucking all right! We're gonna do tonight a whole lot of fucking.
We're all gonna get laid. The song's about my herpes. It's called Don't Leave Me. It goes like this.
Don't Leave Me, not about herpes.
I can quote every joke on this album all the way through.
Uh-huh.
I know every bit of banter. And, like, I was doing that this morning, making pancakes, just like that song ends. Wow! I'm fucking in the mood.
Yeah.
To party! Like, it's ingrained in my brain.
It's weird when things that are references are new to other people. Having my childhood right before the internet, I feel like we were in like the last generation of people that grew up without phones in our hands, and we know older references that kids today would never know. But this was a instance of me not knowing that "We're All Gonna Get Laid" was a reference until like a year or two ago.
Oh, what's the reference?
It's the final line of Caddyshack.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't know that. But like the thing is, I know references to things I haven't seen.
Yeah.
I've never seen Citizen Kane. I know all the references. You know what I mean?
Totally.
And that's mostly from The Simpsons, probably. Whenever I watch like an old movie, I'm like, oh, I've seen The Simpsons parody this before.
Oh, yeah. Simpsons has ruined pop culture for you.
Yeah.
Like anything that predates it. Yeah, it feels like Caddyshack, like that era of comedy, is like right in line with like their upbringing.
Yeah.
Of what they thought was funny. Let's see how they end "Don't Leave Me."
Excuse me.
Thank you.
Hey, Mark. We have a very special person here that wants to say hi. You guys, this is Satan.
Hello, kids. If you guys will take off your pants, then maybe I'll be a little bit more happy. I want to have fun with you, but I'm going to have to see your dick. Plural. I have to go away now. Because there's another song. And I've got a boner. You guys mind if I get a boner, kids?
The Entrance of Satan.
South Park movie just came out.
Uh-huh.
Like 6 months before this album.
Again, I knew about this before South Park Satan.
So, do you remember when, like, Comedy Central aired the South Park movie at, like, 1 a.m. to skirt censorship laws?
No.
On like a Tuesday in like 2000, shortly after it was out on VHS and DVD. So it was about the same time for me.
So you saw it that way?
Yeah.
That's cool.
And this, that one reminds me specifically. So I worked at the pool snack bar, and my like family were members of this neighborhood pool. And I very distinctly remember
build that pool?
No. Play it.
I wanna see some naked dudes. That's why I built this pool.
Is that really it?
We, like, I remember sitting there while my mom was talking to another mom, and I have the CD in my Walkman, listening to it in my headphones. And I take it out because, like, another mom sees that I'm listening to Blink-182 and starts telling my mom, I took my kid to see them and they are awful. They're just wildly inappropriate. They were making really offensive jokes the whole time. We left after the second song. Whoa, and I just felt so bad for that kid whose mom it was. Because, yeah, I get in the car and my mom's like, so is that music you're listening to, like, really that inappropriate? And I'm like, I don't think so. Okay, and that was the end of it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Pay no attention to the sticker on the bottom left side of this.
Well, it was the Australian import, so it didn't have the sticker.
Hilarious. That's awesome. I'll never forget. March 2003, my mom and stepdad took me to see Sum 41, who I had just become obsessed with, my first punk rock show. And they're at the Norva in the top tier where you can like see the floor below. And like me and my cousin are right up front. And Derek Wibley asks everybody to do the 41 salute, which is four fingers on your right hand and put your left hand with your fucking finger up in the air just like this. And
remember when the middle finger was like such a big deal at rock shows?
Yes. And it was the drive home. My mom and stepdad were just like, we had no idea you were like that. We had no idea you had that in you. You always just seemed so innocent. But they were very whatever. They were just like, well, we took him to the concert. It was like a very before and after moment to them of like, they thought I was totally innocent. And then they saw that and they were like, I guess we can't stop whatever he's listening to from this point on.
Yeah. So Travis says in an interview, probably about 60% of the time what they're saying between songs is genuinely funny. But the other times, that's when I'm kicking or doing something behind the drum set to say, hey, let's go, let's play a song. They tried before to get me involved, like, hey, get a mic, tell a joke. But that's just not my style. I'd rather play a song.
It's what makes them seem so cool, honestly. Yeah.
Like the straight man in this band of right. like goofy guys. Yeah.
I was watching a live video earlier. If you type in Blink-182 Live 2001, it's whatever the first one that comes up was. There's a very like outright Travis shutting Tom up moment.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'll play it here. He just interrupts him and starts a song. He's like sick of it.
There's a new song about when you really like a girl, you take her on a date, and you want to give her a kiss.
All right. Aliens exist.
I'm not like you guys. 12 majestic lies. Tom has sex with guys.
I hear it every time.
So when I saw Angels and Airwaves, and he did the melody of Blink songs, he did the last chorus of Aliens Exist, and the audience all goes, Tom has sex with guys.
That's amazing. Did he love it?
He loved it. It was great.
That's so good. You just reminded me of what I forgot I was going to say earlier. We were talking about walking out of shows before the headliner. The first time I saw, maybe the only time I saw Angels and Airwaves, it was the Subways, then Head Automatica, then Angels and Airwaves. And then I left because the closing band was Thursday and I could not have cared less.
Yeah. Thursday has one good release. It's a split album with Japanese shoegaze band Envy, and they like work on each other's songs together for it.
That's always fun.
Yeah. So that's great. But yeah, couldn't care less.
The first time I ever heard Rancid or NoFX was that split where they did each other's songs.
Oh, that one's good. Yeah, do it again.
Hey, Mark! Who here thinks that I look very similar to Tom Cruise? Thank you.
Yeah.
I think so, too.
Like Tom Cruise in that movie, Born on the 4th of July, that one? Where he's handicapped and retarded and stupid, nobody likes him, and he just shits all over himself, and he's a fucking asshole. Hey!
That was mean.
That's right.
Never attack somebody that shits on himself. Do you guys think it's weird to shit your pants when you're sleeping? Not that I do it, but I did it last night. And I haven't taken a shower since, and I'm wondering if that's what smells.
Oh, poopy! Poopoo, caca! Hey, I wrote this next song. Want to hear it?
You don't have a choice.
It goes like this.
Another pop culture reference that this ruined me for was when I finally saw Born on the 4th of July. I'm just waiting for him to be shitting on himself.
He never shits on himself, does he?
I don't think
never
so.
Seen the movie. I really despise Tom Cruise.
I was going to ask, do we find Tom Cruise attractive?
No, absolutely not. No.
There's like one or two roles maybe, but like I've never seen him as the sex symbol that...
Anything about him is ruined by him being a disgusting person.
Is he disgusting or just a weirdo?
He's a Scientologist and they're just fucking evil.
Yeah.
I really can't get over just his part in this fucked up cult that ruins people's lives. You know, yeah. I hate to be the bummer, but I can't watch a Tom Cruise movie. The only one that I still enjoy is Interview with a Vampire.
Interesting. Okay.
I think it's The Vampire.
Interview.
It's one of those Mandela effects.
Oh, yeah. Whoa. Yeah, great ending with him.
Yeah.
I think he's hot in A Few Good Men. I like him in Magnolia. But the Mission Impossible movies, the later ones, they realize that everyone thinks Tom Cruise is crazy. And those movies capitalize on him being a crazy man. It's the only way they work.
Family Reunion.
Oh, here we go.
It's the 7 words you can't say on television. George Carlin.
Oh, so I was going to say, we were talking about our comedy influences. My first 3 comedy influences ever. Weird Al Yankovic, silly songs, making fun of pop culture. George Carlin, very serious, wordy, commenting on society. And then Blink-182, silly songs, but dirty.
And did you know there is a studio version of this song?
No.
Yeah, and it was released before Enema.
Whoa.
It's on a compilation on Fat Records called Short Songs for Short People. I've heard that. That's where you've got the Green Day song.
Ballad of Wilhelm Fink.
Yeah, and you've got Gwar has a great song on there called Fish Fuck. It's good. It's 100 songs, or 99, because that's all you can fit on a CD. 30 seconds or under. And it's like every punk rock band of the 90s is on there.
What a great idea.
Yeah, it's fantastic. One of my favorite songs is on there. It's one of my favorite songs of all time. It's about 12 seconds long. It's called Don't Start a Band. I could not tell you. It's one of those bands that was like kind, maybe like Good Riddance or something like that.
Uh-huh.
It's a great album. I highly suggest looking up Short Songs for Short People. It's not on any of the streaming services, unfortunately, but you can find most of it on YouTube. I had the CD. It was good.
I never had it. I just had downloaded Wilhelm Fink. But let's hear this live version.
Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, twat. Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, twat. Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, twat. Shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, tits, fuck, turd, twat. I fucked your mom.
Still a staple of live sets.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you so very, very much. Hey, this next song is about falling in love.
What's it about?
I don't know.
This song's about love. Give it up for love.
I'll tell you what I love.
You know what the best part of falling in love is?
Sex.
It's the oral sex.
That's pleasure.
Right.
It really is less than 30 seconds. I would have guessed like 40.
Yeah. And also, yeah, it is before Enema. I think it might be the first recording with Travis, though.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
That's hilarious. You know, he does this thing where, like, he doesn't hit the full power chords when he's palm muting. He just hits the root note.
I never noticed that.
I've been watching these live videos, and, yeah, all the stuff that on the album he would hit, he would palm mute full power chords. Live, he always just hits the root note.
Well, you can tell with those, like, octaves that he's hitting in the second or third shit, piss, fuck.
Uh-huh.
It's a good song.
It is. It is.
It's a good song.
They closed with it once when I saw them.
Yeah.
Silly boys.
Going away to college, I think that the live version is what actually made me like this song more.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
It's a great, great song. And he shouts out his wife in it.
Yep.
But you're so beautiful to Travis.
Letting Travis get a good drum solo in.
Yes.
Hey, Mark!
Hey, if you guys are anything like me, you like to dress up in your mother's underwear and walk around the house trying to seduce your father. What, just me?
I'm like you. I trained you to seduce your dad.
Remember? Yeah, that one time when I walked over to your house and your brother was there with the peanut butter smeared all over his wiener and he's all, come here, boy. Come here. Come here, boy. Come on. Who likes the Skippy? Who likes the Skippy peanut butter?
I think the thing about them that made them such a huge influence on me comedically, because I'm not like a toilet humor person in general, but it's saying what you're not supposed to say.
Yeah.
That's what really worked on me.
So when I heard this as a kid, I was like, man, these guys' parents probably heard this, and that's really gross. But Mark's dad, like, left them. It's, like, out of the picture long ago.
Uh-huh.
So that, like, he can make those fucking jokes because the dude's long gone.
Yeah.
And then Sean DeLong, which is Tom DeLong's brother, apparently thought that shit was hilarious.
Sounds like a character, Tom.
Yeah,
does.
I know. Spelled S-H-O-N.
Oh, weird.
Very
That's
weird.
That's as dumb as DeLong.
Yeah, he was in the military for 24 years, and Enema came out more than 24 years ago, or less than 24 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And military, aliens, I haven't done any research. I'm just going to throw that out there as a thing.
Whoa. Interesting.
Yeah.
Tom does a bit about making fun of people in the military on the Urethra Chronicles.
Cool. Good.
Yeah, I agree.
I'm like fucking, I'm almost a Navy SEAL just by sitting like this.
As a SEAL, you must be serious. You took an oath to defend the Constitution, United States of America, to kill and not to be killed, to die not to be dyed.
We mentioned Travis. I think this live album is such a in-between point between Enema and Take Off Your Pants and Jacket, in that like Travis is like letting loose. He is doing so much more on this than he was on Enema. He's adding fills inside of his rolls. I wish he were a little louder in the recording, but
his drums really pop though. You do get a really good live drum sound.
Yeah. And then Tom says this.
This song's really hard to play. It's really hard to play. I would appreciate it if you don't listen to me for the next 2.5 minutes, all right? Shut the fuck up!
Do we think that's really hard to play? It's pretty hard to play.
Consistently throughout, like, to play it all the way through.
Uh-huh.
Did we ever cover this?
We've definitely covered it a couple times.
Yeah. Did you play the lead?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not the easiest thing in the world to play, but considering other stuff he does, like, the palm mute at the end of the chorus in Aliens Exist, the E-flat to B and then E to B, the
Yeah.
That's harder to play than the What's My Age Again intro.
Yeah.
Especially as fast as they do it on here.
I think
here.
It might have been more because he did not write it. Mark wrote the riff.
Right.
Trying to play along to Jay. Are learning someone else's part is harder than writing your own part, you know?
Tell me about it.
Sweaty. And contrary to what most people think, I think I look better wet. I've been campaigning this for about 2 years now. So throughout the show, you will see me getting sexier and sexier as it gets hotter and hotter. You know?
And
what?
If you watch close enough, you might watch Tom getting fatter and fatter as the show goes on too.
Why would I be getting fatter?
Cause
boobies!
Oh, jeez. Stop it. No.
Bad, you are too young.
You're way too young. Gosh. Let me tell you why you're going to get fatter and fatter, because dog semen is full of calories.
Yeah, don't eat dog semen. We hear that there's heart. It's the number one cause of bad breath. Hey, this song is about when I had too much alcoholic beverages, got kicked out of high school, wrote a song about it, and here it goes like this.
Here it goes.
I just love that he's guzzling dog semen the entire set.
It was in the last one we played, but when he goes like, I tried to seduce your dad. Like, I love that, like, the humor's already, like, pubescent teen stuff, and he sounds like his voice is constantly, like, in the middle of changing.
So, in a review of the album by Rolling Stone, they're commenting on the adolescence and the silly dick jokes and things, and they say they don't use drugs, but their tour rider demands a supply of beer, which they supposedly routinely donate to the road crew. Hoppus and DeLong's antics mask a mature streak that gives their fondness for fart jokes and references to each other's penises in itself seem shocking. So these guys aren't on drugs.
Oh.
And they're making these jokes.
That makes it a little more innocent, I guess.
I think so too, yeah.
I like that they include in here that you're too young.
Yeah.
Like, they're not being fucking dogs and, like, being stoked about seeing some 14-year-old titties.
Same review. Nevertheless, the band's tendency to celebrate audience members flashing their breasts drew criticism.
But they don't celebrate it. They say, don't.
We'll get to the end of, like, you've got giant boobs and I doubt you're 18.
That's true. That's true.
Hey, Mark.
What the fuck do you want, Tom? I'm sick of you. Hey, Mark. Hey, Mark, hey, look at this. Hey, look at how I can make it bigger if I rub it. Look at this. Hey, Mark, come here.
No, seriously, Mark, hey. Hey, Mark. I wasn't really masturbating. I've never done that. I was inspecting my testicles for weird bumps.
That's what you say. If your parents ever catch you, I wasn't masturbating. I was just cleaning it, and it went off.
You guys want to hear a song that I wrote about 4 days ago? You really don't have a choice. You might as well be into it.
Yeah, you might as well act like you want to hear it, because otherwise we'll play it twice.
Yeah, you bastards.
two things in there that have stuck with me forever. The build up through six songs of "Hey Mark," and then Mark getting so annoyed with
what him. What the fuck do you want?
It's so good. And I was just cleaning it and it went off. It's such a great joke. Like, that's a legit, like, joke, yeah. Not just a dumb thing you shouldn't say.
Yeah.
But they stumble on it. It's so cool that, like, I watched them do an interview about, like, how they never say the same thing on stage twice. He's like, if I get a good laugh, maybe I'll do it for a few nights in a row. But, like, none of it's planned. It's all improv. It's like a game of, like, how many different jokes can you make about the same three subjects?
Yeah.
And they're just kind of masters at it.
Definitely.
And now we get the blowjob song.
No, we get one of the... This is the second song that we haven't covered yet. They claim they wrote it 4 days ago. Do you think that to be true? I think they maybe wrote it 4 days before tour.
Yeah, maybe.
So the CD version of this, it's not Dick Lips.
It's Rich Lips.
It's Rich Lips. I was looking at that and I was like, huh, it's Rich Lips. And do you think that it's because they didn't want two penis references directly next to each other?
I guess. I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, because I think it was Blue Job.
It was.
Too.
That was, yeah.
So maybe it was all just a weird censorship thing.
Such a strange decision. Like, a parent would look at him and be like, Blue Job, that's fine.
It'd be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job. It would be nice to have a blow job from your mom.
Blowjob is a great setup punchline because you think the joke is entirely that they wanted a blowjob, and then it turns out to be a your mom joke.
Yep. It's the only song on the album without any banter.
Oh, shit.
Yep.
All right. We can skip on down then. That's a good factoid.
Oh, that song's done. We're done with that song now. You guys can rest.
Satan has something to say.
Are you guys having a good time tonight? I'm having a hum-diddly-do of a good time tonight. I like poetry and flowers and pictures of unicorns.
Thousands of naked boys.
And a thousand naked children molested by a breeder.
Wait, what are some of the things that Satan loves?
Satan loves unicorns, pictures, and poetry and long walks on the beach.
Hey, pay attention, you fuck booties!
Yeah, that's actually really funny. I've never thought about that. Pay attention, you... And then he's distracted. I've never thought about that. Now, Satan is both Mark and Tom.
Yeah, that was a Mark Satan, I think.
Yeah. Because Tom says something that Satan responds to.
Yeah.
But there's bass being played during it.
I think that they're... I don't know. Apparently they had like a second mic sort of off stage that they would go up to. So I'm sure he's still got the bass around his neck and just goes up to the other mic that has the vocal editor on it. First time they're using live vocal editing is Satan. And then you get towards the 2020s and they're...
That's all they do.
Straight up auto-tuning themselves on stage.
So during Voyeur, they do the James Brown thing of he runs out.
I need oxygen to the stage, please.
Yeah. Hang on.
Hey,
the song's not quite over yet, but
the song's not done. We have to prepare for the bass guitar solo. How are you doing?
I need oxygen to the stage, please.
You need...
Oxygen and oral sex to the stage, please.
And maybe some of those male chromosomes. To the stage.
Here's where I do the big bass solo, people. Give it up for me!
Here it comes. Here it comes. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
you kids to know that I'm gonna think of every single one of you tonight when I'm all alone inside my bunk. Starting with you. I'm starting with you.
So he's doing the bit from the song,
from Don't Leave Me. They're actually doing the James Brown bit in the middle of Voyeur.
Yeah. I love the constant breaks in this live album for Mark to prepare for bass solos that are really fucking simple.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Especially after seeing Anti-Flag last night. Yeah.
And I think that's more of the joke.
Uh-huh.
Because there are way more complicated bass parts on this that he's doing well singing.
Yeah.
And then just like, hold on, we've got to prepare for the bass solo. And then it's three notes.
I gotta say, I never thought he was like bad at bass, but he's better than I ever realized.
Oh, certainly.
Like having done, doing this pod, like paying attention to what everyone's doing individually.
Yeah.
He's doing cool stuff.
You might not have noticed that, but we are professionals at what we do, which is professionally suck and professionally act like a bunch of assholes on stage. That's what we do. We're just as God made us.
Hey, you better wipe that shit-eating grin off your face, because this next song's a sad one. And more importantly than that, if you're eating shit and grinning, then today's probably not your day anyway, so whatever.
That's one of my favorite little, because it's not even like really a joke.
It's a great riff. like he says something serious, and he's like, wait a second. It's a good one.
We also, the guitars, he tuned down another whole step for this.
Oh.
And Mark sings higher because of it.
Trace the chord back to the wall.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it does.
Which is real interesting. And you get more of that on the self-titled episode, where in the documentary they're recording I Miss You, and he's recording I Miss You like at a way higher register.
Mm.
And then they moved it down 2 frets. And I think that Mark's voice kind of works better live in a higher register, but on recording at a lower register, possibly to counteract Tom's higher voice.
That makes sense. I dig that. I like how Mark fluctuates the melodies that he's singing on this live album compared to like ways he sang them on Enema or Cheshire Cat or whatever.
Yeah.
Like he has fun ideas for what to do with the melodies sometimes. Adam's song is such a left turn from the vibe of them. I'm surprised they ever performed it live, to be honest.
It was a hit.
Fuck with me? Why?
Well, not really. You don't say the with me part. Just the fuck part. That's
okay.
Oh, let's try that one more time.
He just wants you to say fuck.
Yeah, not the with
me. But he wants you to say it with him.
With me.
Okay, go ahead. Try again, Tom.
Do I count to three and then say it? How do we do this?
It goes 1, 2, 3, fuck.
Okay.
Okay, cool.
1, 2, 3! All right, that's the better.
Here we go.
I am amazed that all of this was in 2 nights.
Yeah.
Like, they do a lot of fucking talking. It's insane.
It's like a third of the show, maybe more.
Yeah.
I choose to blame my parents for giving me a small, bent wiener and an ugly face. Hey, do you guys, you know what I noticed, Mark?
Yes, I do.
What, do you know what I noticed?
Yes.
Yes.
I noticed that throughout the many years of me playing with my own wiener, it bends to the wrong side. I think I pulled it too far to the something, the right. Do you guys care? There's something seriously wrong with my dick, kids, and I need your sympathy.
So I do that bit all the time with people, and no one ever gets. But like, you know what? Yes.
Now that I think about it, I never realized that's what you were doing. Yes, I do.
This is just devolved to us repeating what they're saying, but I don't care.
No, that's one of my favorite little bits. You know what I noticed, Mark? Yes.
And then Tom thinks he misunderstood him. And Mark doesn't care.
Kind of, okay. Now I can believe that they're not on drugs or drunk during this.
I think they might be drunk.
Yeah, maybe a little.
Wow. Yeah, because they are listening to each other. Like, it's like a two-man comedy duo.
Yeah.
It's so cool. Who do you think's funnier?
Mark.
Me too.
I think that Tom is trying a little harder, but like that one's great. I choose to blame my parents for giving me a small bent wiener and an ugly face.
Hey, to those listening, go to any other YouTube video from these tours. All of these are different. Like, I haven't heard any of these repeated on anything.
Yeah.
It's fucking bonkers.
You guys want to hear from Satan again?
Well, hello, kids. Are you enjoying the show so far? Chances are you're all going to get laid tonight. I want to sleep with every single person here. Starting with the retard. Sorry, kids, I'm not very funny anymore. Hey, I just been.
Wait. Oh, wait, what if we did something like this? Hey, Satan!
That's Tom?
Hey, I just wondered if I'm gonna get laid tonight.
Why, no, you're not, Tom.
Why not?
Because your dick's small, dark, and ugly.
Alright. Am I funny or what?
Solid editing.
Great edit, yeah.
Hey, I want to tell you how it's going to work for the rest of the show here. We're going to say that this is our last song, we're going to play it, then we're going to walk off stage, but it's really, we're not even done yet. We're going to come back out and play two more songs even after that. So that's how it works. You know how it works. You go and you see a band play, they walk off stage, you're all, thanks a lot, good night. And you know those motherfuckers are going to come back out and play two more songs anyway. So you know what? At least we're straight about it.
They call it an encore.
Yeah, it's an encore.
Encore. Say it with us, kids. Encore.
You ever done an encore before?
Yes.
Did AJM do one?
I thought you were setting me up for a joke. I thought you had a punchline. No, I don't think we have.
Can I get an encore? Do you want more?
No, I do a lot of off-course. It's where I leave early because no one likes me.
No, the one time I was the Harrison 4, my band in the early 10s, got our very last show. We did an encore.
Oh, yeah.
Because it was our last show. Everyone that was there for us. We had a couple like crowd favorites. Uh-huh. So we closed the set with the first crowd favorite and then...
Waited to see if people asked for one?
No. We did. I did that.
Oh,
note for note.
Nice.
I was just like, you know, we're gonna go off the stage and pretend like it's over. Then we came back and did for some reason it became like a joke that we would cover Weezer. Mm-hmm. So we would come back and do El Scorcho and then
Ay caramba.
Yeah, and then did our like big hit. But it's because you know it's gonna happen.
Uh-huh.
It's almost required now, and I kind of think that's bullshit. Because I mean, the encore used to mean something.
Yes.
Like holy shit, the show is so energetic that they're gonna play more.
Last night people were going so crazy with the one more song for like 3 minutes straight. I was sure Anti-Flag was going to come back out.
They didn't do one?
They didn't.
Good. Cool.
Yeah. You're right. You know what? Yeah. All I needed was for you to say cool for me to reframe that.
Fuck yeah. That's special. Like, because maybe they do an encore at another show. Like, it used to mean something. And then even by 1999, when this was being recorded, it was like, hey, you know what's going to happen because we haven't played all the small things yet. So... when we say that it's over, you know we're going to come back and play all the small things.
Right. And this is a way better way to address it than, like, the Foo Fighters. Dave Grohl famously has a sense of humor, but Foo Fighters, he goes, like, we don't do any of that encore shit. We want to use the time we have here to not be backstage. We want to play more songs for you and rock out more. And then they'll do, like, several covers. It's like you want people to rock out to Foo Fighters more, but then you're going to waste time doing... under pressure. Yeah. That doesn't really add up.
I think I might have done encores other times when I was on tour with other bands, like filling in. There is something to be said about that, like, brief couple of minutes. Smoke a cigarette, take a second, and then go back and give it all you got.
Be able to focus on the last couple songs without thinking about needing to pee.
Yeah. I mean, because I've seen Springsteen do like an hour-long encore. The fuck, dude? That's a set.
Yeah. True. Since this is the only live episode we're doing, one thing I did want to talk about from the first time I saw Blink in 03, something they did as a joke, which is now like standard, is 03 is like the first time we're all like getting cell phones. So they go, we want everybody to, instead of lighters, you all have your cell phones, we want to put those up in the air and wave them for this song. It was like, I Miss You or something. And it seemed so funny because nobody had ever thought to do that before. It was like we were all laughing putting our cell phones up in the air. And now it's just so standard at any huge show to see tons of cell phones.
I hate that. I really do. I'm old, so I'm going to complain about that. But not going to complain much about it, but yeah. I bring a lighter. I don't smoke anymore.
I don't know. It looks cool during Boulevard of Broken Dreams to see 80,000 flashlights on phones around you. I don't know.
All right, let's go through this.
Show party, I'm gonna start sucking dicks and squeezing titties. Maybe I can put my pee-pee in your mouth. I love it when the kids come on over and I get to have them suck and kiss my pee-pee tenderly and gently. I like it when the kids sit on my lap and talk about unicorns and flowers and things like that. Maybe I'll even fuck their blood. See kids later.
Fuck their blood.
It's okay because it's Satan saying it.
Yeah, it's true. Ken is peeing. I figure if we're going to listen to Blink-182, we're going to make some piss jokes. Surprisingly, there are no piss jokes on this album. Very few jokes about peeing yourself. I don't know how to host a podcast without Ken, so we're going to wait a second. Everyone, goodbye.
Are you talking to the show?
About you being gone.
Oh. I had to go beat my meat. What I like about that part is he goes... the leave now and beat the traffic, stick around, beat your meat line doesn't get a huge response, and he still goes, I'm gonna say that from now on.
It's pretty funny though.
It's very funny, but like, it's all about self-satisfaction. It's so masturbatory. Like, they're only doing what they find funny regardless of what anyone else does.
Yep. Mutt is a weird choice of an encore song.
Do you think this is all in order? You said it was only two nights, I was thinking of like looking up the set list.
Yeah, it's worth it. I mean, it seems that Mutt was an encore song though. A weird three song encore.
Well, they say when they're talking about coming back for the encore that they're only gonna come back and do two songs, and then there's more after this. So I always assumed these were added from multiple shows.
I'm not sure. We did our research, guys.
Also, American Pie, huge at the time.
Yeah.
So,
oh yeah.
To me, that's
that makes sense.
A lot of people know them from seeing them on screen while this song's playing.
We really love each other. We are the best of friends. Fuck Mark, Travis. You guys mean a lot to me, man. You know what I mean? He needs an ointment. Hey, I think every single pharmaceutical drug should be in ointment form, and it can only go on your balls. You know? Like if you have a cold, you gotta rub ointment on your balls. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Oh, shit. Oh, fuck, I'm gonna start dancing.
I do think that every medication should come in gummy form.
Yeah.
I've been pushing that a while.
It's a great idea.
Yeah. Not everyone has balls.
Well, everyone can get balls. It comes with the ointment.
Dad, your penis is the biggest thing my butt's ever.
So I think it also, like, what South Park has become and what it was when they're making these jokes are very different.
Are they?
I think so. South Park is so far up its own libertarian ass now.
No, South Park's just always been against everyone. It's complete nihilism.
I just think that it was more goofy fart jokes and things. Because I don't necessarily think of Blink-182 as, like, libertarian wieners. But they were real into South Park at the time.
True. That's a good point. I would be curious to see if somebody who we, like, support and like people like us, was in the mainstream, if South Park would try to take them down. Because, I mean, I don't mind at all South Park taking equal shots at Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, and Joe Biden, you know?
Well, they all suck. That's not what I'm saying.
Right, I know. So, but who is prominent? What ideas are prominent that, they never had, a Bernie bashing thing?
The man-bear-pig thing.
Which they did an episode saying they were wrong about.
I guess so, but you shouldn't have to do an episode saying that you're wrong about something.
It was 20 years later.
I mean, sure, but it wasn't quite 20 years. But you know what I'm saying. Like, South Park has just become, this libertarian, nihilistic, nothing matters, so why should anything matter kind of thing. It appeals more to the edgelords of the world.
It does. I'll give you that.
And do you like Steve Albini as a person, as a producer, as a thing?
All I know is he did Nirvana.
He did everything.
Yeah.
He's another Jerry Finn Pixies type producer that worked with a lot of amazing people. He was also in Big Black, who had some pretty problematic music, and he was in a band called Rape Man. And there was an interview with him came out a couple weeks ago with Vice or one of those things, where he's basically like, yeah, I need to take responsibility for my part in breeding edgelords.
Oh, wow.
For, the fact that in the 80s, white men that were thought they were progressive kind of thought that racism and sexism had been solved. And I think that carries for the next couple of decades.
Yeah.
Where we're talking about if Blink-182's stuff would be problematic now. I think it's the same sort of thing where these jokes were harmless because they weren't meant to be harmful.
Mm-hmm.
But when you look at him in the context of how terrible things are.
Right. Mark and Tom never wanted to make anyone mad. If moms got mad, they were just like, oh, well, moms got mad. But South Park wants to piss people off.
Yeah.
I get what you're saying. That makes sense.
We're at the end of the live portion. So then we have the fade into Man Overboard, which I think was done really well. And that's a Jerry Finn move.
Yeah. As a kid, not knowing how any of this worked, I just assumed they did one more song live.
I mean, it's definitely obviously a studio recording.
Now it's obviously, yeah.
Things about this song. I mean, obviously this song is about Scott.
Mm-hmm.
It's about their relationship with their former drummer, and you have the callback that I mentioned in Dude Branch of So Sorry It's Over.
Let's take some time to talk this over. You're out of line and really sober. We can't depend on your excuses, cause in the end, it's fucking useless.
You can only lean on me for so long. Bring the ship about to watch a friend drown. Stood out on the ledge, beg you to come down. You can only lean on me for so long.
It's also one of my favorite little things that I learned today. Jerry Finn plays rhythm guitar on this song.
Whoa, weird. Yeah. I didn't know he was ever a studio musician.
I didn't either.
Sense.
Yeah, no, he plays rhythm guitar on Man Overboard, which fits into the narrative of him being the fourth member of Blink-182.
That's cool.
Only person to play guitar on a Blink-182 album other than Tom until, Skiba in 82.
Interesting.
This is, I think this might be possibly my favorite Blink-182 song. I'm in a sort of country goth band right now called Black Thursday, and we're covering this.
Oh,
and
nice.
Doing like a real weird sad country version of this song.
That's really cool. I can't wait to hear that.
Yeah, I didn't tell the band it was a Blink-182 cover until we had arranged it.
Really?
Yeah.
So you just taught it to them?
Yeah. And then it's like, hey, we're covering Blink-182, fucking deal with it.
That's
like,
awesome.
Yeah, it's fine. It's my first band in a very long time where I am just the ringleader, just doing all the writing and stuff. And I was just like, yeah, here's Man Overboard. Played the song, they all figured it out, and I was like, cool, that's a Blink-182 song.
Word.
Because the lyrics are fucking just, they're very meaningful. It's obvious that it is a song that means a lot to them as a band.
Yeah, it doesn't feel thrown together in any way. It feels very thought out.
It was initially, there's another version of it that was recorded for Enema of the State, but they felt like Adam's song was the sad song. They didn't need another one.
Interesting. I don't think about this as a sad song. It's just more of a serious song. Adam's song sounds sad. This just sounds good.
Yeah. And that's it. That's the live album.
Man on a mission. Can't say I miss him around. Insider information. Handing your resignation. Loss of a good friend. Best of intentions I found. Tight-lipped procrastination. Yeah, later. See you around.
All right, well, we were listening to that song. Our buddy, our guest on the next episode showed up a little bit early. If you're this far in the illusion of this being released every week as if we're recording every week.
I was 10 minutes late. It's just these go long.
Yeah.
Mike Engel.
Well,
you'll get a proper
intro. We'll intro you next episode.
Yeah, don't worry about me. Don't mind me. All right. So
we're at the end. We're going to listen to the bonus tracks. There were 26 bonus tracks.
Oh my God.
On the CD version, which on the streaming version, they have just combined into one 10-minute track labeled Shut Up and Play a Song.
And as a child, I thought they ended the show and then they just talked and talked and talked.
I did too. I really did. I thought they just stood on stage for 10 minutes and talked.
Mikey, what's your experience with this live album?
I listened to it and, you know, the jokes, they were good. They were the typical, the Tom says something, Mark says something, Tom says, your mom! And that's, I love it.
You get the format.
It's about it. We've been talking about that for an hour and a half.
10 minutes of that, and okay. Yeah, that's literally the only, in quotes, new material from this. My experience also with it is, it's kind of weird to me to be like, hear the new drummer on the old songs. Like, what was really the point of that except to say, wow, Scott really sucks. On top of Matt, Man Overboard being on the album and that being like the album exclusive, aside from the jokes.
That is a little painful. But like I've said in previous episodes, I think that Scott would be considered a very competent, good drummer.
Oh, yes.
He's not been followed by Travis Barker.
Yeah.
You know?
Definitely.
But other than that, I mean, aside from semi-feeling bad for Scott, but again, Scott did it to himself. But also, not really. I mean, alcoholism. But I mean, let Ken talk.
I was just saying, I can relate.
Sheesh.
Talk about Man Overboard.
Let's do 10 minutes of jokes. Okay, let's listen to some boob jokes.
So here's what's happening. I listened to this live album a lot over the last week, but I didn't listen to these tracks. So these will just be live reactions to these jokes, and we'll pause if necessary.
Won't be necessary.
I'm going to come back, and I'm going to start a therapeutic massage center only for
I'm going to start my own nudist colony.
Just shut up, Tom, right there.
That would be gross. You tried that in our bus one time.
I tried to start our own nudist colony one time in our bus, and it's pretty much just me hanging out naked. They love you, Tom.
They love me, so fuck everybody else.
New track. They love you, Tom. You can tell it's a new track.
Yeah, fuck all you guys out there that are cheering. We hate you, Tom. You suck dick. Burn in hell.
Yeah. Fuck that. Hey, I say fuck the hating Tom thing. That's what I say. Are we ready, Mark?
You know what it is? You know what it is? A lot of these people are just now jumping on the We Hate Tom bandwagon. I've been hating Tom since like 1995. I'm old school hating Tom guy, all right?
A year into the band.
Yeah. Well, do you think initially Mark did hate Tom because Tom was trying to get with his sister?
Whoa.
We never really covered that. All right, I don't know if he was necessarily trying to get with his sister.
He knew the sister.
Yeah, I think he was trying to get with his sister's brother.
Oh, okay. That would be something Mark
and
would
start
say.
A band.
I like how this track is like my most cherished memory of this live album, but like look at the play counts on here, Mikey. Like,
let me see.
Nobody's listening to this.
Yeah, nobody, literally nobody.
I think you have to complete a play for it to count. Or at least get more than halfway through.
That makes sense.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Nobody gets halfway through this.
No. We'll see if we do.
Let's all say some dirty words. Everyone say fuck.
Fuck.
Everyone say shit.
Shit.
Everyone say dick.
Dick.
Yeah. Everyone say Mark's an asshole.
Mark's an asshole.
Everyone say we hate Mark. Yeah.
Hey, now let's do this one. Everyone say fuck, fuck, shit, fuck.
Fuck, 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 shit, fuck.
That's the kind of words you should be using at home, kids.
That's right.
What do we do now?
They're actual.
Call me an asshole again.
Only bad
What's
influence.
Up? I like your hair. It's very nice.
You like his hair? Oh, cool. Thanks. He probably appreciates that a lot.
No, I wanted to say I liked your butt, but I thought that was too forward, you know?
Hey. This next song.
Because that's
is for
why
all
that's
the
wrong.
Ladies in the house. Yeah. It's for all the ladies in the...
Hey, Mark!
In the house.
Mark!
What? There was a flash video of this bit.
It's for all the
in the early
in
2000s.
Like on all, like, albinoblacksheep.com or something. Newgrounds, one or the other.
Hey, you know
what?
Hang on. I want to make this like a big...
Excuse me.
Excuse Tom.
Sorry.
I want to make this like a big golf tournament. Farts and burps. Everyone shut up. Everybody just clap like it's a golf tournament.
That's what it sounds like when I get done having sex. 15,000 people cheering me on. I could take all you in my bed right fucking now.
It's weird to be like 11 laughing at jokes by people who have had sex about sex without ever having had
sex.
Do
you think they'd had sex yet?
I love that.
He's only 22, like 23.
Good point.
I mean, I love Mr. Eve 6. It was like I was literally a virgin when I wrote the Blender song.
Wow. Is that true?
That's what he said.
That's what he said on Twitter. So we assume it's true because everything people say on the tweet. It's absolutely true.
I believe
you
every tweet.
That.
Mr. Eve 6 guy, we want you on this show.
Yeah. He's the lead singer of Smash
You
Mouth,
have got though. Giant boobs, and I doubt you're 18. Do you have a note from your mom? I want to meet your mom.
Hey, put those 13-year-old boobs away.
No.
If I wanted to see 13-year-old boobs, I'd hang out by the junior high like my dad does.
You know what I learned?
More disses on his dad that left him.
Yeah.
My dad's wiener was bigger than mine then, and
we'll get
still
to that
is.
Next album.
Oh, fuck you, Tommy. Fucking hey, you're gonna burn in hell and die a horrible, fiery death because we think you're a stupid piece of shit.
Fuck you, Tom. We fucking hate you. We think you're gonna burn in hell and die a horrible, fiery death because you're a piece of shit.
Whoa.
I heard that. You want to give me your shirt?
Who's he talking
this
to?
This smells like blood and feces. Dinner time! Okay, what does this say?
It smells like blood and feces. So, it's your dad's shirt?
Hey,
Mark hates his dad.
Like every other man, he believe in a safe form of sex.
Go from the self-titled. He hates his dad.
So, Mark's going to tell you about how safe
Let me tell you about the safest form of sex. It's when you get super drunk and you have sex with like 10 people totally unprotected and you do intravenous drugs at the same time.
It's true.
No, it's not true.
It's not true. You got to carry a weapon. It's not true. How many of you guys have girlfriends and how many of your girlfriends have guy friends? I hope you're not having
and
sex.
Polyamory wasn't
how
quite
many
accepted
of
yet.
Have
no.
because we believe in the love.
Can we talk about something real quick, Mikey?
Mm-hmm.
You're playing drums live while we talk always reminded me of this shit.
Yeah, yeah. To basically end it.
Just play it.
End it or quit while you're ahead. Yeah.
Quit while you're ahead. That's what it is.
Honestly, you probably never got ahead. Quit before you go. Quit before Ken gets any ideas and then verbalizes them.
Quit before a Sum 41 song starts.
Yeah. Bow, bow, bow.
The most special kind of love of all is a love that exists between two naked women while I watch.
We need her to put her shirt back on.
Please.
It just took away my boner. My boner goes down. I had one and now it's gone. Hey,
please,
Mark.
I saw your boobs and my wiener ran away. Hey, hang on. Everyone, seriously, I need your attention for just a second, please. I think somebody lost a contact down here, so everyone look around. A contact lens. Hey, someone lost a contact lens, so...
I lost my virginity.
Keep an eye out for it.
I lost a testicle.
That is my favorite joke on the whole thing. I think
what
it's so goddamn funny. The idea of 30,000 people need to start looking around.
They do.
Hey, what if testicles are things you could lose on an everyday basis? That would suck. You only got three. Hey, I gotta go pee-pee.
You wanna go pee and I'll talk to the kids for a second?
Do you think you can talk for enough time?
No.
Why don't you gather your thoughts enough?
Why don't you just wet your pants and we'll call it even.
Should I just piss in my pants right here? If you guys all each pitch in a dollar each, I'll piss my pants right here now. That should make me about $200 maybe.
I'll give you $300 to piss your pants right now.
I'll give you $440
bucks each, you know?
Sold!
Apparently, there's a kid that's hurt right now. I think they're helping him out right now. Looks like they're right there.
Make a hole, people. Make a hole.
Tom's a better man than Travis Scott.
Yeah, exactly. The Tom, Mark, and Travis Scott show.
I wish now, you know, let me tell you guys something.
I'm gay.
There's thousands and thousands of people here today. There's like semis and fucking buses and multiple bands and all kinds of shit. I wish now I would have taken bass lessons. Sorry.
I wish you did.
Sorry.
Too.
I'm thinking for Christmas next year I'm going to ask for lessons.
I know a guy. I forgot about this. He has sex with his sister. He used his dick to pop her. 4 foot blister, and I know it's not that cool. He fucked her in my swimming pool. He's got 3 testicles, and he loves to do shit.
Yeah.
I always forget about that hidden track.
That was all improvised, right?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah.
Not doing it.
And no bass.
One question about that pool, though. Who do you think built it?
Whoa. Probably naked dudes.
Play it.
I want to see some naked dudes. That's why I built this pool.
Is that really it? Hey, how come every time we say a joke, it has to be about fucking sex, masturbation, incest, or anything gross like that, you know?
Is there anything else in the world?
There's nothing else to talk about.
It's like self-critting their own live album.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm having so much fun right now. Hey.
Excuse me, security guard, sir.
The one right in front of you, yeah.
That girl right there needs to come out. If you're a small person, the front is not the best view. And if you hate seeing shitty bands, any of this is not a good view. Everything, every seat here. Mark's middle name is Rebecca. They thought
that's
it was,
right. It was my middle name is Rebecca because my dad wanted a girl. He treats me like one.
I still have to go pee, and I'm holding it in still. I'll piss my pants, though, for money. I'll eat a nugget of my own poop for $20. I'll pay you $20 and I'll eat it.
You shaved your ass.
You have hair on nothing but your balls. You got Mark has no hair on his whole body but a fucking Wolverine growing in his pants, I swear to God. He's got teeth and shit.
It's true.
He's got a scary looking penis.
It's true. I need your tax deductible donations for the Shave Mark Balls program, please.
To charity, kids.
Send what you can. Donate your time.
You guys think that we're touring for our own? No, this is a...
You got to donate your time because there's so many pubes. It takes a while to shave them off.
There's no metal strong enough to be the teeth on any kind of electric shaver.
Time more than money.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, or amount of pubes. He got shit stuck in there.
You want out there know how to play guitar? That guy's right there.
Does anybody right know there. How to play guitar? Because I'm not very good. People don't really respect me.
If I were a girl, every time I went to the gynecologist, I'd fake an orgasm.
I knew a girl in high school who thought they were really dumb, and then I played that track, and she was like, all right, that was really funny.
See, there you go, yes.
And then I lost my virginity to her.
Whoa.
There you go.
We're going to point out every single person that didn't sing.
Santa Claus
and then she died.
Come to your house and shit under all your true. Trees.
Santa Claus is going to come rape your dogs. Oh, God. You know what? I'm kind of ashamed of being myself today. And yesterday and the day before that. Not really proud of who I am or how I look. Everyone has to have one of those days where you like, just don't even really like what you're wearing, you know? Don't like how your hair looks. And kind of bummed about how your penis is so small and bent and weird.
Tom's got to be hung, right?
He comes with
interesting question.
He comes with with some big dick energy.
Yeah.
We don't have any hard confirms or denies.
I've never considered it.
He just talks about a small bent. It's got to be the straightest, biggest schlong you've ever seen.
That's hilarious.
He's,
Why would he need this much approval, though, if that was the case?
That's true.
Not that that says anything about people who speak into microphones.
Yeah, Tom's Dirk Diggler.
That is the ugliest butt I have ever seen. Let's hear it for not wiping! This guy, fuck wiping, dude. Brings down the rainforest. Okay, this is a song I wrote.
That guy has a science fair project on his ass.
What? Heads up, seven up. Yeah, everyone close their eyes, and if I come by and put my finger in your butt, you're the one. I think Satan has a couple comments.
I like how it runs out of steam here at the end. Yeah. Like,
well, kids, it's been a really fun show. And I want you all to know that we'll come back soon. But before I go, I want to say, I think Tom is extremely good looking and all the girls out there should think he's good looking. Tom has one of the best butts that I've ever seen. Shimmy, shimmy, Coco Pop, shimmy, shimmy, right. Shimmy, shimmy, Coco Pop. Does anybody here want to sleep with me? I'm really a nice guy. It's really not Satan.
It's me. It's not Satan. Let's all be happy he's not here. Say, fuck Satan. All right. Hey, I'm out of jokes and out of songs. I think we're done.
All right. We sure did it.
Out of jokes. How many did you have, Tom? Mikey, are they stand-up comedians?
They've probably influenced many, many terrible stand-up comedians.
Yeah!
But other than that, yeah, I mean, you know, if that was literally 10 minutes of their best material.
Oh, that was the worst material.
Oh, okay.
Best material was kept on the...
On the actual. Okay, yeah. That makes sense. Yeah. Yeah, it's just been very long since I've listened to the live album. But yeah, if that was just the collection of the chaff, I mean, again, I see terrible increments of 5 to 10 minutes weekly, so I don't know.
All right. Yeah. We've been talking about this for too long. We're going to go ahead and leave it to that. We're going to move on to doing other things because we're not recording the next episode till later, right?
Yeah.
And we hope
you've
had
a dog in your ass.
God, suck your motherfucker tits, fart-turned butts.
I fucked your mom.
I fucked your Tom.
Well, I guess this is growing up. Well, I guess this is growing up. Well, I guess this is growing up. Well, I guess this is growing up.